بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. الحمد لله رب العالمين، وأصلي وأسلم على أشرف الأنبياء والمرسلين، نبينا وحبيبنا وقرة أعيننا محمد بن عبد الله عليه وعلى آله وأصحابه أفضل الصلاة وأتم التسليم. أما بعد، فإن أصدق الحديث كتاب الله، وخير الهدي هدي محمد صلى الله عليه وسلم، وشر الأمور محدثاتها، وكل محدثة بدعة، وكل بدعة ضلالة، وكل ضلالة في النار. وقال تعالى في كتابه العزيز بعد: أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم، بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. إنا أنزلناه في ليلة القدر وما أدراك ما ليلة القدر. ليلة القدر خير من ألف شهر. تنزل الملائكة والروح فيها بإذن ربهم من كل أمر. سلام هي حتى مطلع الفجر. صدق الله العظيم. All praise and thanks be to Almighty Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, who is our creator, sustainer, nourisher, protector and curer. May the choicest of his blessings and salutations be upon our beloved master Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, his family members, his companions and all those who tread upon his path with utmost sincerity until the day of qiyamah. O children of Adam, first and foremost I admonish myself and then all of you all who are present here to adopt a life of taqwa. For it is only through a life of taqwa can a believer attain success in this world as well as the hereafter. And that is to adopt the fear of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and to be conscious of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala during every single second of our lives. May Allah the Almighty make us all from the people of taqwa. Secondly, it is incumbent upon all of us to thank Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for the numerous bounties that Allah the Almighty, our beloved Maker, has conferred upon us. The numerous bounties. Even if we were to try and count those favors of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, we would fail to enumerate all of the favors of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. As He Himself says in the Noble Quran, وَإِن تَعُدُّوا نِعْمَةَ اللَّهِ لَا تُحْصُوهَا. If you were to try and enumerate the blessings of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, you would not be able to encompass all of the blessings of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. My dear respected elders and brothers in Islam, the Ummah of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, Allahu Akbar, the nation of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is indeed a blessed Ummah. For all of us, our whole Ummah, we keep constantly moving from virtue to another virtue. We keep moving from one mercy of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to another mercy of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Our powerful Maker, Allah the Almighty, Azza wa Jal, He created all of His creation and then afterwards He gave superiority, He gave virtue to some of His creation over others. As Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in the Noble Quran, وَرَبُّكَ يَخْلُقُ مَا يَشَاءُ وَيَخْتَارُ. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He creates what He wills, what He wishes, what He desires, وَيَخْتَارُ. And He chooses what He wills and what He desires. Allahu Akbar. Allah the Almighty created the heavens. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala created the heavens and Allah the Almighty gave virtue to the seventh heaven due to the proximity of that heaven to the arsh of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, upon which He ascended in a manner that befits His majesty and His glory. Jalla Jalalu. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala created the malaika, created the angels, all of the angels. And then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gave virtue to Jibril alayhi salatu wasalam. He gave virtue to Mika'il alayhi salatu wasalam. He gave virtue to Israfil alayhi salatu wasalam. Mika'il alayhi salatu wasalam, who has been given the responsibility of the rains and the provisions. Israfil alayhi salatu wasalam, who has been given the responsibility of blowing the trumpet. He has already placed the trumpet on his lips, waiting for the command of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to blow it to signify the commencement of the day of judgment. Allahu Akbar. Jibril alayhi salatu wasalam was given superiority over all angels. Allah the Almighty made him archangel. He is the angel responsible of bringing wahi, bringing divine revelation from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to the messengers of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Allah the Almighty created Jannah, and then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gave superiority, gave virtue to Jannatul Firdaus over all other Jannah, all other paradises. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala created mankind. Allah the Almighty, He created all of us, and then He gave superiority, He gave virtue to the Anbiya alayhimu salatu wasalam, to the Prophets alayhimu salatu wasalam. And from the Prophets, from the Anbiya alayhimu salatu wasalam, Allah the Almighty, He gave virtue to the Rusul, to the messengers alayhimu salatu wasalam. And from the messengers, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gave virtue, gave superiority to the Ulul Azm, the five special prophets. And they were Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam, Nuh alayhi salatu wasalam, Ibrahim alayhi salatu wasalam, Musa alayhi salatu wasalam, and Isa alayhi salatu wasalam. And from the Ulul Azm, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, out of His infinite mercy, He gave virtue and superiority to two of them, and He made them His Khalil. He made them His friends, and they were Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and Ibrahim alayhi salatu wa salam. And from the two great friends of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, Allah the Almighty gave virtue, gave superiority to our beloved Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam by making him the greatest prophet of all and by making him the best of mankind. All of this is from the virtues, from the blessings of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Likewise, my dear respected elders and brothers in Islam, Allah the Almighty did not create all of time equal. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala attached virtues to some days over other days, to some months over other months, to some nights over other nights. The best of days, according to the hadith of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, is Friday, is the day that you and I, we are seated in. Allahu Akbar. Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is reported to have said, خَيْرُ يَوْمٍ طَلَعَتْ عَلَيْهِ الشَّمْسُ يَوْمُ الْجُمْعَةِ, that the best of days upon which the sun has risen is Friday. It was in this day, it was on this day that Adam alayhi salatu wasalam was created. And it was on this day that Adam alayhi salatu wasalam was admitted entry into Jannah. And also it was on this day that Adam alayhi salatu wasalam was taken out of Jannah. From the months, my dear respected elders and brothers in Islam, Allah the Almighty has attached so much of virtue and given preference to the month that we are rapidly heading towards, the month of Ramadan. Allahu Akbar. And now comes about the topic for today's sermon. Make this Ramadan count. The topic for today's sermon, inshallah ta'ala, will be make this Ramadan count. My dear respected elders and brothers in Islam, the month that we are headed towards, the blessed month of Ramadan, is a month known as Shahrul Quran. It is known as the month of the Quran. It is known as Shahrul Taraweeh. It is the month of Taraweeh. It is known as Shahrul Judi wal Infaq. It is known as the month of generosity and the month of spending. It is known as Shahrul Qiyam al-Layl. It is known as the month of Qiyam al-Layl, because most of us will be involved in night worship towards Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. This is why Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was overjoyed when he was expecting Ramadan. When the month of Ramadan was near, Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam used to be so overjoyed. He used to be excited, waiting for the month of Ramadan. Hadith is in Nasa'i. Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is reported to have said, Atakum shahru Ramadan. Atakum shahru Ramadan. Shahrun Mubarak. A month is coming towards you all. The month of Ramadan, a blessed month. Faradallahu azza wa jalla alaykum siyamah. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has made obligatory upon all of you all fasting in that month. Tuftahu fihi abwaabu as-samaa'. The doors of the heavens will be opened in that month. Allahu Akbar. Wa tughlaqu abwaabul jahim. The doors of Jahannam will be slammed shut in that particular month. Wa tughallu fihi maradatu shayateen. Many narrations, in other narrations too, it has been mentioned that the devils will be locked up. They will be chained and locked up. Wa fihi laylah. And in that blessed month, in the month of Ramadan, there is a night. There is a night. خَيْرٌ مِّنْ أَلْفِ شَهْرٍ. It is better than 1,000 months. Allahu Akbar. There is one night that is better than 1,000 months. مَنْ حُرِمَ خَيْرَهَا فَقَدْ حُرِمْ. Whoever is deprived from the blessings of that night or that month is indeed the one who is utterly deprived. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala not make us from the ones who are deprived of the blessings of the month of Ramadan. Ameen. Our Salafun as-Salih, our pious predecessors, they used to pray to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala very sincerely, very earnestly, Ya Allah, give me a chance to attain the month of Ramadan, the coming month of Ramadan, before you take my life. Allahu Akbar. Ya Allah, prolong my life so that I attain the coming month of Ramadan. Because the month of Ramadan is such a blessed month, such a noble guest. All of us, we need to prepare ourselves, starting from now, it's not too late, to welcome that noble guest who is headed our way. Allahu Akbar. My dear respected elders and brothers in Islam, have you ever thought about the virtue of attaining the month of Ramadan? Have you ever thought about the virtue of attaining the month of Ramadan? Hadith is in Ibn Majah. Hadith is in Ibn Majah. The hadith goes along the lines of these words. Two men go to Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. They go to Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and they proclaim, Ya Rasulullah, we wish to accept or embrace Islam. Two men embrace Islam on the same day. From these two men, one of them used to exert himself excessively in good deeds. He used to involve himself in jihad. He used to involve himself in da'wah. He used to exert himself more than the second individual. And this first brother, he passes away as a shaheed. He dies on the battlefield. He passes away as a shaheed, a martyr. The second individual, he passes away a year later after the first individual passed away as a shaheed. Now, a sahabi by the name Talha ibn Ubaidillah radiyallahu anhu, he saw a dream. This sahabi radiyallahu anhu, he saw a dream. In that dream, he saw himself in front of the gates of Jannah. Allahu Akbar. Talha ibn Ubaidillah radiyallahu anhu, he saw a dream and he saw himself in front of the gates of Jannah, and he saw these two individuals. The one who passed away as a shaheed and the other individual who passed away, who died a normal death 1 year later. Both of them were also in front of the gates of Jannah. Whilst he was observing this scene, an angel comes out of Jannah and admits the second individual, the individual who passed a year later after the shaheed, the individual who died a normal death. He admits him first into Jannah and closes the gates and goes away. After a while, the angel comes back again and then admits the individual who passed away as a martyr, as a shaheed, Allahu Akbar. He goes in second and then he closes the gates and moves away. After some time, the angel comes again and now faces Talha radiallahu anhu and informs Talha radiallahu anhu, Ya Talha, ارجع, go back, for your time has not come. Ya Talha, you may go back because your time has not come. The minute the angel said that, Talha radiallahu anhu woke up from his slumber, from his sleep, and he was shocked at the dream that he witnessed. He goes about telling people because he's shocked, he's surprised. He ends up going and informing Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wasallam about the dream. And Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wasallam very calmly asks Talha radiallahu anhu, Ya Talha, what is it that surprises you from the dream that you witnessed? Talha radiallahu anhu, because of his ardent desire, not because he was questioning the dream or questioning the decree of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, nay, his ardent desire was to find out what was the special deed that this second individual had done to make him enter Jannah before a shaheed. Allahu Akbar. So he informs Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam as to, in regard to why he was surprised. Now what we need to understand, my dear respected elders and brothers in Islam, that the status of a shaheed is not ordinary. The rank of a shaheed is not something ordinary. It is natural for Talha radiallahu anhu to be amazed, because the daraja, the rank of a shaheed is much, much higher. So he was surprised as to how did this second individual go into Jannah before the shaheed. Because a shaheed is an individual who Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala blesses with 6 special traits, 6 special qualities. Number one, before the first drop of his blood spills onto the ground, all of his sins will be forgiven and he will be able to see his place in Jannah. Allahu Akbar. Trait number one. Trait number two, there will be no punishment for the shaheed in the grave. No adab for him in his grave. Number three, he will not be scared, he will not be terrified on the day when all of mankind will be terrified and will be running helter-skelter. This man will be calm, the shaheed. He will not be scared, he will not be terrified. A shaheed is a person who will be given a crown of honor on the day of judgment. Trait number four, he will be given a crown of honor on the day of judgment. That crown will be so special, it would glitter and it would have jewels and gems encrusted all around that crown. And just one jewel from that crown is more valuable than this whole world and all it contains. Allahu Akbar. Trait number five, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will bless him with the most beautiful of spouses he could ever imagine. This is quality number five. And the final trait is that he will be given the permission to intercede on the behalf of 70 of his family members to get them out of Jahannam into Jannah. Allah the Almighty will permit him to do that. Allahu Akbar. This is the daraja of a shaheed. So no wonder Talha radiallahu anhu was surprised. He was amazed. How come this second individual entered Jannah before the shaheed? Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam then asks Talha radiallahu anhu, Ya Talha, did not the second individual witness one whole year after the shaheed? Talha radiallahu anhu replies in the affirmative. He says, Bala, of course, Ya Rasulullah. Did that individual not witness another month of Ramadan? Talha radiallahu anhu replies, Bala, yes, of course, Ya Rasulullah. Then did that individual not pray this kind of a prayer? Did he not make sajda more than that individual? Talha radiallahu anhu replies, Bala, Ya Rasulullah. Then Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam goes on to say along the lines of these words, that the difference between the shaheed and the individual who stayed a year back, who witnessed another month of Ramadan, who involved himself in other acts of worship, the difference between these two individuals is like the heavens and the earth. Allahu Akbar. My dear respected elders and brothers in Islam, this narration should fill our hearts with hope. This month of Ramadan, make it count. Do the very best. Be your best in this month of Ramadan. turn over a new leaf, begin a new chapter, turn to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in sincere tawbah before it's too late, my dear respected elders and brothers in Islam. Because I wish to ask you all a question now. And I hope that this question serves as a reality check for you and me, to wake all of us up from the drunken haze that this dunya, this worldly, this materialistic worldly life has intoxicated us. The question is, what if this is your last Ramadan? What if this is your last Ramadan? What if Malakul Maut, that is never going to happen, but hypothetically, what if Malakul Maut has come to you and told you, I give you time until the end of Ramadan, right after the day of Eid, I come to visit you to take your soul. How would you and I behave in this month of Ramadan, my dear respected elders and brothers in Islam? In reality, we cannot even guarantee that we will last till the end of Ramadan. We cannot even guarantee that we would last till we reach home after Jum'ah. Death is an impending reality, my dear respected elders and brothers in Islam. And it is upon us to remember death excessively. Just as how our beloved master Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is reported to have said, hadith is in Tirmidhi, أَكْثِرُوا ذِكْرَ هَادِمِ اللَّذَّاتِ يعني الموت. Make excessive remembrance of the destroyer of pleasures. Make excessive remembrance of the terminator of pleasures, which is death, which is al-maut. My dear respected elders and brothers in Islam, the more we remember death, the more we make remembrance of death, that would shatter the fake veils of pleasure that this dunya adorns herself with. None of us can guarantee for how long we will last, my dear respected elders and brothers in Islam. What if by the time we reach our homes, Malakul Maut is standing by the doorway, waiting to take our lives? The question that you and I need to be asking ourselves, are we ready to meet Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? Because Malakul Maut will not give you a second extra, even if you cry tears of blood. If you are supposed to pass away, if you are supposed to die at 1:06 p.m., on the 6th of June 2014, so be it, Malakul Maut, according to the will of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he will be there on the dot. We will not even get a second extra. But we have been intoxicated with this materialistic dunya. We run behind dunya. We hanker behind dunya. We have forgotten Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Are we ready to meet Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? So my dear respected elders and brothers in Islam, turn to Allah the Almighty before it's too late. Make use of the blessed month of Ramadan that we are headed towards. So let us prepare for the month of Ramadan. From the preparations for the month of Ramadan, I would like to highlight on one important aspect, and that is in regard to our salah. My dear respected elders and brothers in Islam, salah is what differentiates us and the kuffar. Salah is what differentiates a Muslim from a kafir. But many of us have lost the understanding of the value of salah. We think of salah as a burden. We think of salah as something that we need to get over with. Allahu Akbar. Salah is the link between us and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, between our beloved maker. We should enjoy salah. We should wait for salah. Say we finish salatul dhuhr, we should wait earnestly for Salatul Asr and then Salatul Maghrib. Our whole day evolves around Salah. Look at the difference of the importance we attach to Salah and the importance the Sahaba Ridwanullahi Ta'ala Alayhim Ajma'in attached to Salah. It was during the Khilafah of Umar radiallahu anhu. One morning, Umar radiallahu anhu goes to the masjid for Salatul Fajr. He goes to the masjid, the Sahaba Ridwanullahi Ta'ala alayhim ajma'in have gathered. Because the Amirul Mu'mineen is the one who generally conducts the salah. He will be the imam. Umar radiallahu an moves forward to conduct the salah, salatul fajr. He makes sure that the sufuf are aligned. All of the rows are aligned, something we will touch towards the end of the khutbah. He makes sure that the sufuf are all aligned. And then he turns to tie takbir. As he ties takbir, the criminal, Abu Lu'lua al-Majusi, Abu Lu'lua, the fire worshipper, he comes and stabs Umar radiallahu an with a double tipped dagger. He stabs Umar radiallahu an multiple times. Umar radiallahu anhu now stabbed, doesn't want to leave salah, but he's weak because blood starts gushing out of the wounds of the stabbing by that individual. Umar radiallahu anhu feels dizzy, feels weak. Immediately he leans on to Abdul Rahman ibn Auf radiallahu anhu and pushes forward Abdul Rahman ibn Auf radiallahu anhu to conduct the Salatul Fajr. The Sahaba ridwanullahi ta'ala alayhim ajma'in, some of them quickly help Umar radiallahu anhu and rush him to his home. Umar radiallahu anhu, the minute he reaches his home, he falls unconscious. Why? Because of the heavy bleeding, he falls unconscious. The Sahaba ridwanullahi ta'ala alayhim ajma'in, they finish the salah and they rush to the house of Amirul Mu'mineen. They see that he has fallen unconscious. Now it is almost daybreak. The sun is about to rise. Now they are wondering, how are we to make Amirul Mu'mineen? How are we to make Umar radiallahu an gain consciousness? What are we to do? Today, what would you and I think? Let's keep some smelling salts perhaps to help the person gain consciousness. The Sahaba ridwanullahi ta'ala alayhim ajma'in immediately come to a conclusion that Amirul Mu'mineen had this importance that he attached to salah. Nothing on earth could prevent him from fulfilling his salah to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So the Sahaba ridwanullahi ta'ala alayhim ajma'in go by Umar radiallahu anhu, who is unconscious now, and say, Ya Amir al-Mu'mineen, it is time for salah. Ya Amir al-Mu'mineen, it is time for salah. Umar radiallahu anhu immediately gets up from his slumber. Allahu Akbar. Is it time for salah? Is it time for salah? This was the importance they attached to salah, my dear respected elders and brothers in Islam. But we, on the other hand, placing multiple alarms for Salatul Fajr, we find it difficult to lift the tiny blanket and make it to the masjid for Salatul Fajr. Umar radiallahu anhu gets up. Is it time for salah? Is it time for salah? Have you all finished Salatul Fajr? He asked the Sahaba ridwanullahi ta'ala alayhim ajma'in. The Sahaba, they reply, yes, Ya Amir al-Mu'mineen, we finished our salah. Then please bring some water for ablution. And then he makes a fresh ablution. And remember, whilst he's still bleeding from his wounds, he makes a fresh ablution and then immediately prays Salatul Fajr. My dear respected elders and brothers in Islam, for a slight headache or a slight fever, we tend to miss so many salawat. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala forgive us all. Umar radiallahu an, even at that crucial moment, he is bleeding heavily. The importance that he attaches to salah is admirable. That is how you and I, we need to behave with salah, with that blessed relationship between us and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So my dear respected elders and brothers in Islam, from the preparations for the month of Ramadan, please establish your salah. Please establish your salah on time with the congregation. These are all things which would take time to touch, but I just want to touch on one very important etiquette in regard to salah, something that most of us are now neglecting, and that is in regard to straightening your rows. Hadith is in Bukhari. Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is reported to have said, straighten your rows, for straightening of the rows is part of perfecting your salah. In another narration, Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is reported to have said, straighten your rows, for straightening of the rows is part of establishing your salah. Hadith is in Muslim. Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is reported to have said, straighten your rows and do not differ in your rows, lest your hearts will begin to differ. Allah save us all. Hadith is in Bukhari and Muslim. Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was aligned shining the rose before Salah. He was straightening the rose and he saw a man whose chest was a bit forward. In other words, he had come a bit forward. Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam immediately said, O slaves of Allah, O slaves of Allah, straighten your rows, or Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will cause disunity amongst you all. Straighten your rows, or Allah the Almighty will cause disunity amongst your hearts. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala save us all. My dear respected elders and brothers in Islam, if there are gaps in the rows, shaitan, the accursed devil, he starts going through the rows like a tiny lamb, causing mischief and corruption amongst the salah. He causes disunity amongst the hearts. He plays around with our minds. It is upon us to straighten our robes. Today we see individuals, due to the heat perhaps, or because he's got this favorite spot in the masjid, what come what may, he does not want to leave that spot in the masjid, or else because of the heat he wants to be right under the fan. Even if there is a gap in front of him, he is not ready to move forward and fill the gaps. My dear respected elders and brothers in Islam, the majority of the ulama, they say that it is obligatory straightening of the rows and filling the gaps, standing shoulder to shoulder, feet together, is obligatory. And if the congregation does not see to it that all of the gaps are filled, the whole congregation is considered as sinners. Allah save us all. The scholars also say, my dear respected elders and brothers in Islam, that it is upon us to straighten our rows based on our heels. We should look back at our heels, and our heels should be aligned together. Today we have some brothers who align the rows based on their toes. Now, the problem with the toes is perhaps some people have got longer toes and some people have got shorter toes. So how are you going to align the rows based on your toes? But heels, everybody has got almost the same heel. So you align your rows based on your heels. And if there is a gap, try to fill up the gaps. Like I said before, at times we have brothers towards the back, and especially on days of Jumu'ah. On the days of Jumu'ah, on Friday, because most of the floors in the masjid are full, we have brothers who stay right at the back. Right at the back, whatever floor it may be, because right after the imam gives salam, they want to rush out of the masjid. This is their relationship with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. They come to the masjid waiting to rush out. My dear respected elders and brothers in Islam, we must give importance and priority to the first row. We must give importance and priority to the first row. Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is reported to have said, لَا يَزَالُ قَوْمٌ يَتَأَخَّرُونَ حَتَّى يُؤَخِّرُهُمُ اللَّهُ. As long as a nation, as long as a group keeps delaying themselves or keep going behind from the first row, Allah, in the sense, the hadith is along these words, the nation that delays themselves, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will delay for them. Imam al-Nawawi rahimahullah, he writes in his sharh of that hadith, he explains in regard to the hadith that it is in regard to individuals who delay from coming to the first row. If they delay coming to the first row, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will delay in regard to sending good to them, in regard to conferring his blessings and virtues upon them. So we need to compete with one another. There should be a healthy competition amongst ourselves to make it to the first row of the masjid, because the first row is the row that is given virtue, my dear respected elders and brothers in Islam, not the last row, not the row by the door, so that you can rush out right after salah. My dear respected elders and brothers in Islam, I hope I have touched on the importance of aligning your rows. This is also part of perfecting your salah and preparing. In other words, perfecting your salah is part of the preparation that we can prepare for the month of Ramadan, so that we can welcome that blessed guest who is about to visit us soon, and so that we can make that blessed month of Ramadan count this time. And my dear respected elders and brothers in Islam, as a closing note, I admonish myself and then all of you all to turn to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala before it's too late. And like we mentioned about death, before malakul maut comes in front of you and before the sun rises from the west. For if either one of the two occurrences were to occur, the doors of tawbah would be slammed shut. And even if we were to cry tears of blood, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala would not accept our tawbah. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala forgive all of our sins. And may He the Almighty accept all of our good deeds. And may He unite us, just as how He united us here this afternoon with our beloved Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam in the gardens of Jannah.